The second reading is from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 26 through 39, which is found on page 944 of your pew Bibles. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charges against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is it to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, or persecution or famine, or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You pray with me. Dear Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. All afternoon, a little boy tried to put together his birthday gift from his father, a picture puzzle. Some of the pieces were bright and some were dark. Some seemed to go together, and others didn't seem to fit anywhere. Finally, frustrated and exhausted, and with nothing to show for his efforts, the boy gathered the pieces, put them back in the box, and gave it to his dad. "I can't do it," he explained. "You try it." To his amazement, his father had assembled the entire puzzle in just a few minutes. "You see," he said, "I knew what the picture was like all the time. I saw the picture in the puzzle, but you saw only the pieces." Paul tells us in our reading that God causes all things to work together for good. Those all things are the pieces. He then tells us how they work together for the good, according to God's purpose. That is the picture. Are you perplexed and frustrated over this event or that happened in your life? Don't take the situation out of God's hand and try to work it into your own design. God knows the picture of your life and what it is composed of, and God will complete it if you will let him. It's easy to wonder what God is doing when bad things happen in our lives. We may look back on our lives and wonder what we did to deserve such things. The truth is that things happen that we don't deserve. God has given us all the freedom to choose what we do or what we don't do. Christians have no more protection against drunk drivers, storms, or disease than atheists. It's just part of life. And because something bad happens does not mean that God has caused it to happen. God does not send us trials and tribulations in order to punish us. But God does help us to walk through them and can redeem them if we allow it. Now we may be less likely to put ourselves into situations where bad things are more likely to happen, such as being out and about in the early hours of the morning when many questionable decisions are made. But then we might put ourselves in places of desperation trying to help others, so one never knows. We do know that bad things happen to good people. We all know that. And it is in these times of trial that Paul tells us that the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. Like the boy taking the puzzle to his father, we can give our troubles up to God and experience God's peace. As Paul wrote to the Philippians, "The peace of God which transcends all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ." Sometimes Christians are able to weather the storms of life better than those without faith, because we are able to trust in God to find a way where we see no way, or to work good from evil. We remember the story of Joseph, whose brothers sold him into slavery out of jealousy, and then had to face him during the times of famine. Joseph faced many trials, such as unjust imprisonment during his time as a slave in Egypt, not to mention being a slave in Egypt. But Joseph made the best of the situation to become the second in command of Egypt, behind only Pharaoh. So he was able to store away grain so that many would survive during the time of famine that was coming, where most did not. When he was finally able to confront his brothers over the wrong that they had done him, he was in the position to pay them back in spades. He could have paid them back with slavery, imprisonment, or even death if he wished to. Do you remember what he did? He said, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God used it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." My sister is a professional worrier. She admits that she worries about things that will probably never happen, but in doing so, she is convinced that somehow she keeps them from happening. I suppose there's a sort of twisted logic in this, but it's so unnecessary. But I do understand it, because I enjoy being in control of my life as much as anyone. But there is so much in life that is outside of our control. All we can do is the best that we can do and trust God with the rest. As Jesus tells us, "Who of you by worrying can add even a single hour to your life? Since you cannot do this very little thing, why do you worry about the rest?" In fact, worrying probably takes hours from our lives, but we do it anyway. It's part of the human condition. But Paul tells us, "I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth or anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Knowing this should give us hope that no matter what we go through in life, we will never be separated from the love of God in Christ Jesus. When we feel the most alone, Jesus is right there beside us. When we feel the most powerless, Christ carries us until we are able to walk on our own. We have a choice when bad things happen. We can give up and withdraw from life, or we can keep moving forward, expecting that the good will return. We don't find the good by not looking for it, do we? It is something that we all face in life. And I can't think of anything more tragic or devastating than the death of a child. It's something that can tear families apart. Yet even that can be overcome. On January 13th of 1996, a 9-year-old girl was abducted while riding her bike in Arlington, Texas. Her body was found 4 days later, about 5 miles from home, with her throat slashed. I can't imagine what that would do to her parents. If that doesn't make somebody just want to crawl away and hide under a rock, I don't know what would. But this young girl's parents got to work, getting a more stringent law passed in Texas that protects children. That crusade led to the creation of a national registry for sex offenders. But it didn't stop there. State and local law enforcement officials were brought together to work out ways to respond more quickly and efficiently in the case of missing children, which led to the development of an alert system for area media and internet outlets to let as many people as possible know to be on the lookout for the missing child. This is the Amber Alert system that we are aware of today, named after Amber Haggard, the 9-year-old girl who was murdered in Texas. God was able to take this family's grief and use it to galvanize them, to work tirelessly so that others might not have to experience the same senseless pain and loss that they did. Rather than hiding away as helpless victims of violence, they became active advocates for justice. God did not cause the abduction and murder of Amber, but God was able to turn this senseless tragedy into something good. God understands the grief at the loss of a child, because God's own son was senselessly murdered. But God was able to turn that into good, the redemption of the world through the forgiveness of sins. We know that all things God works for the good of those who love them, who have been called according to his purpose. Bad turned into good, mourning into celebration. If God is for us, who can be against us? God may not spare us from suffering, for God did not spare Jesus or the apostles from suffering. In fact, Paul was well acquainted with suffering personally when he wrote, "For your sakes, we are facing death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. But in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the past, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ our Lord." Paul spent his last years in chains as a prisoner for Christ. But that did not stop him from writing and teaching and doing everything in his power to continue building up the young Christian church. In both the letters to Philemon and the Ephesians, Paul even describes himself as a prisoner for Christ on behalf of the Gentiles. until his life was ended in martyrdom by the executioner's sword. But Paul's writings live on and encourage the saints of the church across the centuries. Nothing and no one could separate him from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. And nothing and no one can separate us from that love, unless it is us. It is our choice. Will we be victims or will we be conquerors? Will we cling to Christ or turn our backs? Our communion liturgy says, when we turned away and our love failed, God's love remains steadfast. God delivers us from captivity to slay, to sin and death. God is still delivering us from captivity. From captivity to our fears. From captivity to our covetous consumeristic society. Our captivity to sin and death. God is for us. Why do we doubt? Why do we worry? Because we are perfectly imperfect humans. And while we may be going on to perfection, we are not there yet. But God's there, and God is waiting for us. All we have to do is trust and live on in faith. God has the rest. Thanks be to God.